students in general stream as opposed to those in services or technology stream, sciences and technology stream, need their employment opportunities improved. About 150 higher education institutions will start apprenticeship embedded degree program whereby urban local bodies across the country would provide internship opportunities to fresh engineers for a period up to 1 year. So local bodies, as you know, do undertake a lot of public work program and their manpower is also limited, but yet young engineers who are ready to serve for the purpose of learning how it is to work with the government are also going around seeking opportunities. So here we have created an opportunity by saying urban local bodies should now give opportunity for fresh engineers so that they can help them plan better and in turn also learn as an intern under the local bodies. So this is for a period of 1 year that we've opened up. In order to provide quality education to students of deprived section of the society as well as those who do not have access to higher education, it is proposed to start a degree level full-fledged online education program. This shall be offered only by institutions who are ranked within top 100 in the National Institutional Ranking Framework. Initially, only a few such institutions would be asked to offer such programs. Sir, India should also be a preferred destination for higher education. Hence, under its Study in India program, an IND SAT exam is proposed to be held in Asian and African countries. It shall be used for benchmarking foreign candidates who receive scholarships for studying in Indian higher education centers. A national police university and a national forensic science university are being proposed in the domain of policing science, forensic science and cyber forensics. There is a shortage of medical doctors. There is a shortage of qualified medical doctors, both general practitioners as well as specialists. In order to meet this requirement, it is proposed to attach a medical college to an existing district hospital in PPP mode. Those states that fully allow facilities of the hospital to the medical college and wish to provide land at a concession would be able to receive viability gap funding from the center. Details of the scheme would be worked out soon, so we aim to have at the district level with hospitals which are being extended for medical college training and also for producing more doctors, viability gap funding will also be extended. So the National Board of Examination imparts PG medical qualification, diploma and fellow of National Board, DNB and FNB. The government will therefore encourage large hospitals with sufficient capacity to offer resident doctors the DNB and FNB courses under the National Board of Examinations. There exists a huge demand for teachers, nurses, paramedical staff and caregivers all abroad. There exists a huge demand abroad for teachers, nurses, paramedical staff and caregivers. However, their skill sets many a time do not match the employer's standards and therefore need to be improved. I propose that a bridge, special bridge course be designed by the Ministries of Health, Skill Development together with professional bodies to bring in equivalence. Language requirements of various countries need also to be included. All these should be achieved through a special training package. Our government proposes to provide about 99,300 crores for education sector in 2021 and about 3,000 crores for skill development. So I move to the second theme, economic development. Aspirational India, economic development and caring society. I'm now talking on economic development. And in economic development, industry, commerce and investment are the ones which come first in our. So the most important thing as an introduction I'd like to say here, the guilds of Saraswati Sindhu civilization and the Harappan seals are remarkable. Saraswati Sindhu civilization is about 4000 before the common era. They belong, the seals in particular, belong to 3300 BCE, before the common era. Words from the Indus script, which are all hieroglyphs, have been deciphered. Words from those hieroglyphs have been deciphered. Interesting words which we need to know when we're talking about commerce and industry. Commerce and trade-related words show how India for a millennia has been a continuing civilization with rich skills in metallurgy, rich skills in trading and so on. Sreni is a word found in the Harappan seals, which means guild. Seti is a word found in the Harappan seals, which means wholesale merchant. Seti was a wholesale merchant in the Sindhu civilization, Saraswati Sindhu civilization. Poddar is an assayer of metal into treasury. And also, India is a continuing maritime power in terms of commerce and industry. Sakara Khodmi is using word which shows blacksmithery and also iron and tin smithery exist at that time. So India's commerce, India's industry, India's trade in such materials which were all unique to India have existed and continues to exist over the millennia. So entrepreneurship has always been the strength of India. That's the point I wanted to explain. I'm sure many members already know it and therefore they are a bit restless. Entrepreneurship has always been the strength of India. Even today, young men and women have given up greener pastures elsewhere to contribute to India's growth. They are risk-taking and come up with disruptive solutions to festering challenges. Equally, established old industries are resetting themselves in a changing global and domestic situation. We recognize the knowledge, skills and risk-taking capacities and capabilities of our youth. He is no longer a job seeker. He is a creator of jobs. Now we wish to create more opportunities and remove roadblocks from this path. I propose to set up an investment clearance cell that will provide end-to-end facilitation and support, including pre-investment advisory, information related to land banks, and facilitate clearances at the centre and also in the state level. It will work through a portal. There is a case for maximizing the benefits of three separately developing economic activities, sir. The upcoming economic corridors, revitalization of manufacturing activities, and technology and the demands for aspirational classes. We have to benefit from their convergence. Hence, it is proposed to develop 5 new such smart cities in collaboration with states and in PPP mode. Such sites would be chosen that offer the best choices in terms of the aforementioned principles. India needs to manufacture networked products that will make it a part of global value chains. This in turn gets more investment and generates more employment for our youth. Electronics manufacturing industry is very competitive and India has shown its cost advantages. The potential of this industry in job creation is immense. India needs to boost domestic manufacturing and attract large investments in the electronics value chain. Here I propose a scheme focused on encouraging manufacture of mobile phones, electronic equipment and semiconductor packaging. The details will be announced sooner. With suitable modifications, this scheme can be adapted for manufacturing of medical devices too. India, sir, imports significant quantity of technical textiles worth $16 billion every year. To reverse this trend and to position India as a global leader in technical textiles, a national technical textiles mission is proposed with a 4-year implementation period from 2020-21 to 2023-24 at an estimated outlay of 1,480 crores. Honorable Speaker, sir, from the Red Fort, our Prime Minister spoke about quality and standards when he spoke of zero defect, zero effect manufacturing. In September last year, I had called for a time-bound adoption by industry of all necessary mandatory technical standards and their effective enforcement. All ministries during the course of this year would be issuing quality standard order. So to achieve higher export credit disbursement, a new scheme, NIRVIC, is being launched, which provides for higher insurance cover, reduction in premium for small exporters, and simplified procedure for claim settlements. It is proposed to digitally refund to exporters. That was NIRVIC. I am coming to a different point now. It is proposed to digitally refund to exporters duties and taxes levied at the centre, state and local levels, such as electricity duties, VAT, the VAT, on fuel used for transportation, which are not getting exempted or refunded under any other existing mechanism. This scheme for reversion of duties and taxes on exported products will be launched from this year itself. Honorable Speaker, it is the vision of our Prime Minister that each district should develop as an export hub. Efforts of the centre and state governments are being synergized and institutional mechanisms are being created in order that every district becomes an export hub. Government e-marketplace, GEM, is moving ahead for creating a unified procurement system in the country for providing a single platform for procurement of goods, services and works. It offers a great opportunity for medium and small and micro enterprises. 3.24 lakh vendors are already on this platform. It is proposed to take its turnover to 3 lakh crores. I propose to provide about 27,300 crores for development and promotion of industry and commerce for the year 2020-2021. So under economic development, the second point that I want to focus on is a very important point, and it is on infrastructure. Honorable Speaker, in his Independence Day speech of 2019, the Prime Minister has highlighted that 100 lakh crores would be invested on infrastructure for the next 5 years. As a follow-up measure, I had launched the National Infrastructure Pipeline on 31st December 2019 of 103 lakh crore worth projects. It consists of more than 6,500 projects across sectors and are classified as per their size and stage of development. These new projects will include housing, safe drinking water, access to clean and affordable energy, health care for all, world-class educational institutions, modern railway stations, airports, bus terminals, metro, railway transportation, logistics and warehousing, irrigation projects, etc. The National Infrastructure Pipeline envisions improving the ease of living for each and every individual citizen in the country. It will also bring in generic and sectoral reforms in development, operation and maintenance of these infrastructure projects. A huge employment opportunity exists for India's youth in construction, operation and maintenance of infrastructure. National Skill Development Agency will give special thrust to infrastructure focused skills and their development opportunities. I propose to set up a project preparation facility for infrastructure projects. This program would actively involve young engineers, management graduates and economists from our universities. It is also proposed to direct all infrastructure agencies of the government to involve youth power in startups. They will help in rolling out value-added services in quality public infrastructure for citizens. A national logistics policy will soon be released. Among other things, it will clarify the role of union government, state government, and also the key regulators. It will create a single window e-logistics market and focus on generation of employment, skills and making MSMEs competitive. So also, accelerated development of highways will be undertaken. This will include development of 2,500 kilometer access control highways, 9,000 kilometers of economic corridors, 2,000 kilometers of coastal and land port roads, and 2,000 kilometers of strategic highways. The Delhi-Mumbai Expressway and two other packages would be completed by 2023. Chennai-Bengaluru Expressway would also be started. So the fast-track mechanism encourages us towards greater commercialization of our highways so that NHAI can raise more resources. I propose to monetize at least 12 lots of highway bundles of over 6,000 kilometers before 2024. In carrying out its duty, the Indian Railways performs a service to the nation. Within 100 days of assumption of this government, it has commissioned 550 Wi-Fi facilities in as many railway stations. It has eliminated unmanned level crossings and aims to achieve electrification of 27,000 kilometers of tracks. This will call, obviously, for optimization of costs. Railways have small operating surplus. About Indian Railways, there are five measures, among other things, that I wish to highlight. Setting up a large solar-powered capacity. Setting up a large solar-powered capacity alongside the rail tracks on the land owned by railways. A proposal is under consideration. Four station redevelopment projects and operation of 150 passenger trains would be done through PPP mode. The process of inviting private participation is underway. More Tejas type trains will connect iconic tourist destinations. High speed train between Mumbai and Ahmedabad would be actively pursued. 148 kilometer Bengaluru suburban transport project at a cost of 18,600 crore would have fares on metro model. Central government would provide 20% of the equity and it will also facilitate external assistance up to 60% of the project cost. Sir, our seaports need to be more efficient. Technology has to be used to improve performance. A governance framework keeping with global benchmarks needs to be put in place. This government would consider corporatizing at least one major port and subsequently its listing on the stock exchanges. Inland waterways received a boost. Inland waterways received a boost in the last 5 years. The Jal Vikas Marg on National Waterway 1 will be completed. Further, the 890-kilometer Dhubri-Sadiyar connectivity in Assam will be done by 2022. Honorable Speaker, sir, developing waterways has its impact on the ecosystem on both the banks of the river. Our Prime Minister has conceptualized Arth Ganga. Plans are afoot to energize economic activity along the river banks. Air traffic has been growing rapidly in the country as compared to global average. 100 more airports would be developed by 2024 to support the Udaan scheme. It is expected that the air fleet number shall go up from the present 600 to 1,200 during this time itself. I propose to provide 1.7 lakh crores for transport infrastructure in 2021. Sir, taking electricity to every household has been a major achievement of this government. However, the distribution sector, particularly the DISCOMs, are under financial stress. The ministry intends to promote smart metering. I urge all the states and union territories to replace conventional energy meters by prepaid smart meters in the next 3 years. Also, this would give consumers the freedom to choose the supplier and the rate as per their requirements. So this is a very important step in reaching electricity to all people. This would give consumers the prepaid meters, the smart meters, would give consumers the freedom to choose the supplier and the rate as per their requirements. Further measures to reform DISCOMs would be taken. I propose to provide 22,000 crores to power and renewable energy sector for the year 2020-21. So now I come to oil and natural gas. In the upstream sector, oil and gas, the open acreage licensing policy, OALP, is a success, having awarded 1,37,000 square kilometers for exploration to private sector and to the CPSCs. City gas distribution rights are also awarded. Further, it is proposed to expand the national gas grid from the present 16,200 kilometers. At the moment, it is 16,200 kilometers only. We propose to expand it to reach 27,000 kilometers. To deepen the gas markets in India, further reforms will be undertaken to facilitate transparent price discovery and also ease of transactions. So I come to talking about the new economy now. The new economy is based on innovations that disrupt established business models. Artificial intelligence, Internet of Things, 3D printing, drones, DNA, data storage, quantum computing, etc. are all rewriting the world economic order. India has already embraced a new paradigm such as the sharing economy with aggregator platforms displacing conventional businesses. Government has harnessed new technologies to enable direct benefit transfers and financial inclusion on a scale like never before. It's now a cliche, data is the new oil. And it is true that analytics, fintech, and Internet of Things are changing the way we deal with our lives. To take advantage of this, I propose to bring out soon a policy to enable private sector to build data center parks throughout the country. Building data center parks throughout the country. It will enable our firms to skillfully incorporate data in every step of their value chains. Our vision is that all public institutions at the Gram Panchayat level, such as Anganwadis, health and wellness centers, government schools, PDS outlets, post offices and police stations will all be provided with digital connectivity. So, the fiber to home FTTH connections through BharatNet will link 100,000 Gram Panchayats this year itself. 1 lakh Gram Panchayats this year itself will be connected to the optical fiber FTTH program. It is proposed therefore to provide 6,000 crores to BharatNet program 2020-21. We need to expand the base for knowledge-driven enterprises. Intellectual property creation and protection will play an important role. Several measures are proposed in this regard, which will benefit the startups. A digital platform would be promoted that would facilitate seamless application and capture IPRs. Also, in an institute of excellence, a center would be established that would work on the complexity and innovation in the field of intellectual property. Honorable Speaker, sir, knowledge translation clusters would be set up across the different technology sectors, including new and emerging sectors, for designing, fabrication, and validation of proof of concept, and further scaling up technology clusters, harboring such test beds and small-scale manufacturing facilities would be established. Mapping of India's genetic landscape is critical for next-generation medicine, agriculture, and for biodiversity management. To support this development, we will initiate 2 national-level science schemes to create a comprehensive database. The government proposes to provide early life funding, including seed fund, to support ideation and development of early stage startups. So critical to our quantum technology. Quantum technology is opening up new frontiers in computing, communications, cyber security with widespread applications. It is expected that a lot of commercial applications would emerge from theoretical constructs which are developing in this area. It is proposed to provide an outlay of 8,000 crores over a period of 5 years for the national mission on quantum technologies and applications. India would probably be the third biggest and pioneering nation if we are able to break into this technology of quantum technology related to computing and other applications. Sir, I come to the third theme, the last theme in my part A, after which of course I will speak of a few others. Caring society. In our third theme, we focus on women and child, social welfare, culture and tourism, and also on environment and climate change. Women and child and social welfare, sir. I am pleased to inform the House that Beti Bachao Beti Padao has yielded tremendous results. Gross enrollment. Sir, if you hear the data, I think it's important not to politicize issues related to women. Beti Bachao Beti Padao has yielded tremendous results. Gross enrollment ratio of girls across all levels of education is now higher than boys. At elementary level, it is 94.32% as against 89.28% for boys. At secondary level, it is 81.32% as compared to 78% for boys. At higher secondary level, girls have achieved a level of 59.70% compared to only 57.54% for boys. So girls are actually under Beti Padao benefiting from the scheme. Health of mother. Sir, health of mother and child are correlated closely. Nutrition is the critical component of health. To improve nutritional status of children 0 to 6 years, adolescent girls, pregnant women and lactating mothers, our Prime Minister launched a portion of Abhiyan in 2017-18. More than 6 lakhs Anganwadi workers are equipped with smartphones to upload the nutritional status of more than 10 crore households. Sir, Honorable Speaker, sir, for the benefit of those who may not have heard this line, because it's very important, I'd like to repeat it. To improve the national nutritional status of children in 0 to 6 years of age, adolescent girls, pregnant women and lactating mothers, our Prime Minister launched a portion of Abhiyan in 2017-18. More than 6 lakh Anganwadi workers are equipped with smartphones to upload the nutritional status of more than 10 crore households. The scale of this development is unprecedented. So the next is, women's age of marriage was increased from 15 years to 18 years in 1978 by amending erstwhile Sharda Act of 1929. As India progresses further, opportunities open up for women to pursue higher education and careers. There are imperatives of lowering MMR, maternal mortality rate, as well as improvement of nutrition levels. Entire issue of about age of girl entering motherhood needs also to be seen in this light. I propose to appoint a task force that will present its recommendations in 6 months' time. I propose to provide 35,600 crores for nutrition-related programs for the financial year 2020-2021. So in continuing with our government's commitment to welfare of women, this budget provides for about 28,600 crore for programs that are specific to women. Our government is determined that there shall be no manual cleaning of sewer system or septic tank. Suitable technologies for such tasks have been identified by the Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs. The Ministry is working with urban local bodies for the adoption of these technologies. We will now take this to its logical conclusion. We will now take it.
एक मिनट बंद.
To
मैं सभी माननीय सदस्यों से आग्रह करूंगा, आप वो बजट पर पर्याप्त समय और पर्याप्त अवसर दूंगा, उस समय आप बोलना, और दादा विशेष रूप से आपको बोलने की परमिशन दूंगा.
Thank you, sir.
No.
Thank you, Speaker, sir. We will now take this. We will now take this to its logical conclusion through legislative and institutional changes. Financial support for wider acceptance of such technologies will be provided. In furthering this government's commitment towards the welfare of scheduled castes and other backward classes, I propose a budget provision of about 85,000 crores for 2020-21. For scheduled castes and other backward classes, I repeat, I propose a budget provision of about 85,000 crores for 2020-21. In furthering the development and welfare of scheduled tribes, sir, I provide in the budget for the year 2020-21 an amount of 53,700 crores. For scheduled tribes, I repeat, we provide 53,700 crores. This government is mindful of the concerns of senior citizens and Divyang. Accordingly, an enhanced allocation of about 9,500 crore is being provided for 2020-21. So now I move to the second of the third topic theme that I have, which is culture and tourism. Our government proposes to establish an Indian Institute of Heritage and Conservation under Ministry of Culture. It shall have the status of a deemed university to start with. Acquisition of knowledge in disciplines such as museology and archaeology are essential for collecting and analyzing scientific evidence of such findings and for dissemination through high-quality museums. Currently, lack of trained manpower is a handicap for both these disciplines, and therefore it also has a negative impact on tourism. Five archaeological sites would be developed as iconic sites with on-site museums. They are Rathi Ghadi, Haryana; Hastinapur, Uttar Pradesh; Shiv Sagar in Assam; Dholavira, Gujarat; Adichanallur, Tamil Nadu. I repeat, five archaeological sites would be developed as iconic sites with on-site museums. They are Rathi Ghadi, Haryana; Hastinapur, Uttar Pradesh; Shiv Sagar, Assam; Dholavira, Gujarat; and Adichanallur in Tamil Nadu. Our Prime Minister in January 2020 announced recuration of the Indian Museum in Kolkata, which is the oldest in the country. In the historic old mint building, Kolkata, a museum on numismatics and trade will also be located. Four more museums from across the country shall be taken up for renovation and recuration so that a world-class experience can be offered to our visitors. Our government shall also support setting up of a tribal museum in Ranchi, Jharkhand. So I spoke about the Sindhu Saraswati civilization. A maritime museum would be set up at Lothal, the Harappan Age maritime site near Ahmedabad, by the Ministry of Shipping. I propose to provide 3,150 crore for Ministry of Culture for the year 2021. Sir, India has moved up from the rank 65 in 2014 to 34 in 2019 in the Travel and Tourism Competitive Index, the World Economic Forum's index. Foreign exchange earnings grew 7.4% to 1.88 lakh crores for the period January to November 2019 from 1.75 lakh crores. From 1.75 lakh crores, it has gone up to 1.88 lakh crores. Growth of tourism directly relates to growth and employment. States have a critical role to play. I expect the state governments to develop a roadmap for certain identified destinations and formulate financial plans during 2021 against which specified grants will be made available to the states from the center in the year 2020-21. For purpose of tourism promotion, sir, I propose to allocate 2,500 crores for 2020-2021. So I now move to the third under this theme, environment and climate change. In September 2019, the Prime Minister has launched the Coalition for Disaster Resilient Infrastructure with its secretariat in Delhi. This global partnership is the second such initiative, international initiative, after the launch of, as members would recall, after the launch of International Solar Alliance. That was in 2015. This global partnership will help in addressing a number of sustainable development goals, as also the aims of Sendai framework. It will enhance climate change adaptation with a focus on disaster resilient infrastructure. India submitted its nationally determined contribution under the Paris Agreement in 2015 on a best effort basis, keeping in mind the development imperative of our country. Its implementation effectively begins from 1st January 2021. Our commitments as action will be executed in various sectors. Honorable Speaker, sir, I interrupt here only to say this is a very important point, because a lot of our commitments which have been given in the Paris Climate Change Conference on best effort basis will start kicking in from 1st January 2021. Our commitments as action will be executed in various sectors by the departments and ministries concerned through a normal budget process. They will do it through the normal budgeting process. There are, however, yet thermal power plants that are old and their carbon emission levels are very high. For such power plants, we propose that utilities running them would be advised to close them if their emission is above the preset norms. The land so vacated can be put to alternative uses. In large cities having population above 1 million, clean air is a matter of concern. I'm sure a lot of our members will be keen to know about what steps are being taken for cities and clean air. The government proposes, Honorable Speaker, to encourage such states that are formulating and implementing plans for ensuring cleaner air in cities above 1 million. Parameters for the incentives would be notified by the Ministry of Environment, Forests and Climate Change. Allocation for this purpose is 4,400 crores for 2020-2021. So there is something which, before I move to talking about governance, because the three themes that I put before the members is coming to a close, I fall back on the wise words of Thiruvalluvar. And this, it's very important, sir. We have heard several words of wisdom from Thiruvalluvar. Thiruvalluvar has spoken about what a good country is, what a good country is actually got to be like, and what makes up for jewels of a good country. I first read it in Tamil, then I'll give you the meaning. Pini inmai, selvam, vilai inbam, aimam. Pini inmai, selvam, vilai inbam, aimam. Ani enba, naattin vaindu. Ani enba, naattiv vaindu. There are five, what Thiruvalluvar says, which are jewels for a good country. The first is pini inmai, meaning you, the country will have to be without epidemics or illnesses, major illnesses. The second, he says, it should be wealthy. It should have wealth. It should have wealth. It should also have valachal, in the sense from the fields it should have good crop. It should have inbam. It should have happiness. It also should have aimam, which is security and safety of the country. Sir, the five jewels. Five jewels. Pini in mind, selvam, vilai binbam, aimam, and inbam. Prime Minister Modi. Prime Minister Modi. Ayushman Bharat. Ayushman Bharat for health for all is pini in mind. Selvam. Wealth creators will be respected in this country. Wealth creators will be respected in this country. Selvam. village, having good crops. Farmer PM Kisan, doubling of income, use of fertilizers and proper growth leads to surplus in horticulture, surplus in Silhan, surplus now probably also in Dalhan. So the Prime Minister's program at health, at creating and giving respect for wealth creators and improving agricultural output and looking at ease of living, bringing happiness to people and above all, the fifth aim, this country's national security. You have enough proof to say national security is the top priority of this government. So, if Tiruvalluvar, if Tiruvalluvar,
आपको कुछ होना चाहिए, तमिल में पढ़ा है, बैठ जाइए.
That's right, sir. If Tiruvalluvar identified the five jewels for a good country, those five jewels are the ones which Prime Minister Modi is now addressing through his program. For health, Ayushman, for wealth creators, a respectable and honorable climate, good crops, happiness through ease of living and national security. So, now with all that said, the bouquet of flowers which I would like to give every citizen with trust and faith, had flowers and aspirational India. Had aspirational India a set of flowers and aspirational India. Had set of flowers and environment and economy and also commerce and industry. A third set of flowers was under the caring India, caring society that we want to have. Now this bouquet of flowers is held by two hands, governance and other financial institutions. I speak about governance, sir, which is very important. Good governance is what is going to be giving faith to the people. Honorable Speaker, sir, all the while I have explained the color and composition of the bouquet of flowers, schemes and programs. They were grouped under Aspirational India, Economic Development and Caring India. Now I speak about the two hands that will hold them. One such a hand is governance, which is clean, corruption-free, policy-driven and good in its intent. And most importantly, trusting in faith, trusting every citizen, the aspirational youth, the hard-working women. Honorable Speaker, sir, trusting every citizen, I repeat, trusting every citizen, the aspirational youth, the hard-working women, the risk-taking entrepreneur, the ever-hopeful and untiring farmer, or the wise and old senior citizen. Many among them are taxpayers. Others may not be taxpayers now. Our Prime Minister has laid before us ease of living as a goal to be achieved on behalf of all citizens. An important aspect of both ease of living and ease of doing business is fairness, efficiency of tax administration. We wish to enshrine, this is important, Honorable Speaker. This is important, sir, money being allocated to various programs, it's finance of this country. This is very important, sir. Businesses should have the confidence that things are being fair and the efficiency of the tax administration. We wish to enshrine in the statutes a taxpayer charter through this budget. A taxpayer charter is getting institutionalized into the statutes. It's going to be enshrined as a part of our laws. That's building trust. A taxpayer statute will be a part of our, a taxpayer's charter will be a part of our statutes. Our government would like to reassure taxpayers that we remain committed to taking measures so that our citizens are free from harassment of any kind. We mean it, and we are willing to put it in the law. Tax harassment cannot be tolerated when we are talking about citizens and wealth collectors. There has been a debate about building into statutes criminal liability for acts that are civil in nature. This is important, sir. There has been a debate about building into statutes criminal liability for acts that are civil in nature. Hence, for Companies Act, certain amendments are proposed to be made that will correct this. Similarly, other laws would also be examined where such provisions exist, and attempts would be made to correct them also. The government intends to introduce major reforms in recruitment to non-gazetted posts in governments and public sector banks. At present, candidates have to appear for multiple examinations conducted by multiple agencies at different points of time for similar posts. This places enormous burden on time, effort and cost for young people. To mitigate the hardship so faced, it is proposed to set up a national recruitment agency as an independent, professional, specialist organization for conduct of computer-based online common eligibility test for recruitment to non-gazetted posts. A test center in every district, particularly in the aspirational districts, would be set up. For the speedy disposal of commercial and other disputes, government has constituted various tribunals and specialized bodies. It is proposed to evolve a robust mechanism for appointment, including direct recruitment to these bodies, to attract best talents and professional experts. A stable and predictable business environment is a key objective of this government. There is also a strong argument for ensuring that contracts are honored. India has a sound framework related to Contracts Act. We shall deliberate upon strengthening it. There is a growing need, sir, for Indian statistical system to meet the challenges of real-time monitoring of our increasingly complex economy. Data must have strong credibility. The proposed new national policy on official statistics would use latest technology, including artificial intelligence. It would lay down a roadmap towards modernized data collection, integrated information portal, and a timely dissemination of information thus collected. I am happy to inform that India will host G20 presidency in the year 2022. That is the year of 75th anniversary of independence of the Indian nation. During this presidency, India would be able to drive considerably the global economic and development agenda. For this historic occasion, I allocate a sum of 100 crore to begin the preparations. 100 crore rupees. Sir, northeastern region has a very high priority in government's developmental agenda. Government is ensuring smooth access to financial assistance from multilateral and bilateral funding agencies to help introduce innovative and global best practices. Central government has effectively used an online portal to reduce gestation period of online. This has improved the flow of funds to the northeast region. The government is fully committed to supporting the all-round development of the newly formed Union Territories of Jammu and Kashmir and the Union Territory of Ladakh. Accordingly, an amount of 30,757 crore has been provided for the financial year 2020-21. an amount of 5,958 crore has been provided for the Union Territory of Ladakh. So that was one hand, which is governance. Now I come to the other, which is the financial sector. If governance was described as one of the pair of the hands holding the bouquet consisting of aspirational India, economic development and caring India, the other is the financial sector. A clean, reliable, robust financial sector is critical to the economy. A clean, reliable and robust financial sector is critical to the economy. In our efforts to achieve the US $5 trillion economy, the financial architecture should evolve. The financial architecture should keep evolving and move from strength to strength. We had earlier approved consolidation of 10 banks into 4. In the last few years, the Government of India has infused about 3,50,000 crores by way of capital into public sector banks for both regulatory and growth purposes. Governance reforms would be carried out in these banks so that they become more competitive. A few among them will be encouraged to approach capital market to raise additional capital. So I wish to inform this august house that robust mechanism is in place to monitor the health of all scheduled commercial banks, and that depositors' money is absolutely safe. I wish to underline this point, sir, that this august should know, this august house should know, that robust mechanism is in place to monitor the health of all scheduled commercial banks, and that depositors' money is absolutely safe. Further, the Deposit Insurance and Credit Guarantee Corporation has been permitted to increase deposit insurance coverage for a depositor, which is now standing at 1 lakh of rupees to 5 lakh per depositor. Sir, the insurance cover for a depositor is at 1 lakh now. Now we are raising it to 5 lakh for each depositor. Sir, to strengthen the cooperative banks, amendments to the Banking Regulation Act are proposed for increasing professionalism, enabling access to capital and improving governance and oversight for sound banking through the RBI. The limit for NBFCs to be eligible for debt recovery under the securitization and reconstruction of financial assets and enforcement of security interests under the SARFAESI Act 2002 is proposed to be reduced from 500 crores to asset size 100 crores only, or loan size from existing 1 crore to 50 lakhs. Therefore, we feel many of the small NBFCs which can come for debt recovery would be far easily done for smaller companies. In the last few years, the government has taken concrete steps to bring our banking system to be robust. However, there is a need for greater private capital. Accordingly, it is proposed to sell the balance holding of Government of India's IDBI Bank to private retail and institutional investors through the stock exchange. There is a need, sir, to take further steps to bring in transparency and greater professionalism in public sector banks. The government will take appropriate measures towards this end. Sir, to help easy mobility while in jobs, we wish to infuse into the universal pension coverage with auto-enrollment. Also, we wish to place such mechanisms which can enable interoperability and provide safeguards for the accumulated corpus. Regulating role of PFRDAI, which is the pension regulatory body, requires strengthening. Necessary amendments would be carried out in Pension Fund Regulatory Development Authority of India Act that will also facilitate separation of NPS Trust for government employees from the PFRDAI. This would also enable establishment of a pension trust by the employees other than from the government. I am confident that this will motivate citizens to plan for their old age. So this section which I will now speak will relate to the MSMEs. MSMEs are vital to keep the wheels of our economy moving. They also create jobs, innovate, and also risk takers, and they are risk takers. Several measures for the MSMEs have been taken in the past few years. There are more steps proposed in this budget also. I propose to make necessary amendments to the Factor Regulation Act 2011. This will enable NBFCs to extend invoice financing to the MSMEs through TREDs, thereby enhancing the economic and financial sustainability. Working capital to credit remains a major issue for the MSMEs. It is proposed to introduce a scheme to provide subordinate debt for entrepreneurs of MSMEs. This subordinate debt to be provided by banks would count as quasi-equity and would be fully guaranteed through the Credit Guarantee Trust for medium and small entrepreneurs. The corpus of the CGT MSE would accordingly be augmented by the government. More than 5 lakh MSMEs have benefited from restructuring of debt permitted by RBI in the last year. The restructuring window was to end on 31st March 2020. Government has asked RBI to consider extending this window till 31st March 2021, one more year, so that whoever wants, they can go and approach. An app-based invoice financing loans product will be launched. This will obviate the problem of delayed payments and consequential cash flow mismatches for the MSME. Many mid-sized companies are successful domestically, but not in export markets. For selected sectors such as pharmaceuticals, auto components and others, we propose to extend hand-holding support for technology upgradations, R&D, business strategy planning and so on. A scheme of 1,000 crore rupees will be anchored in the Exim Bank together with the SIDBI. Both these institutions would contribute 50 crores each. This 100 crore would be achieved towards equity and technical assistance. Debt funding of 900 crores from banks would be made available. Sir, financial markets. I would like to give a few of the major steps and initiatives being taken by the government for the financial markets. Last year in my budget speech, sir, I had mentioned about deepening the bond markets. To achieve the aspirational growth rate, we would require flow of capital in our financial system. A lot of work has been done on this in consultation with the RBI. Honorable Speaker, sir, I am pleased to inform this House of the developments. Certain specified categories of government securities would be opened fully for non-resident investors, apart from being available to domestic investors also. The limit for FPI in corporate bonds, currently at 9% of outstanding stocks, will be increased to 15% of the outstanding stock of corporate bonds. To improve investors' confidence and to expand the scope of credit default swaps, we propose to formulate a legislation to be placed soon before this House for laying down a mechanism for netting of financial contracts. The debt-based exchange-traded fund, the ETF, recently floated by the government was a big success. Government proposes to expand this by floating a new debt ETF consisting primarily of government securities. This will give retail investors access to government securities as much as giving an attractive investment for pension funds and long-term investors. So to address the liquidity constraints of the NBFCs and the HFCs. This was very much talked about between July and December last year, sir, 2019. Liquidity constraints was very frequently mentioned to us. So to address liquidity constraints of the NBFCs and the housing finance corporations, post the Union Budget 2019-20, the government formulated a partial guarantee, credit guarantee scheme for the NBFCs. To further the support of providing liquidity, a mechanism would be devised. Government will offer support by guaranteeing securities that are so floated. Infrastructure financing. Government's commitment for investment in infrastructure was reiterated when 103 lakh crore national infrastructure pipeline projects were announced. I would also like to inform that about 22,000 crores of rupees has already been provided as support for infrastructure pipeline. On December 31st, if honourable members would recall, a national pipeline consisting of more than 6,500 projects were announced. 22,000 crore has already been provided as support to infrastructure pipeline. This would cater for equity support to infrastructure finance companies such as the IIFCL and a subsidiary which is of NIIF. So two institutions, IIFCL and the subsidiary of NIIF take it. They would leverage it as permissible to create financing pipeline of more than 1 lakh crores. This would create a major source of long-term debt financing for infrastructure projects and fulfill a long-awaited requirement.